Today we're going to talk about Emmanuel and the fact that we need a Savior. Because at Christmas time, we really have such a great time. It's so beautiful. I enjoy it so much. I enjoy buying gifts for my kids. I have to tell you what really makes me nuts. I enjoy shopping. Okay? And I don't enjoy the shopping, but buying all this stuff. I enjoy meeting people and talking with people. And I have to tell you, the bigger the sales are at Christmas, I get so much of a blessing for this, the bigger the Muslim turnout. Did you know that? I mean, I met some Muslim women the other day who were actually from the Middle East. And you know, we talk about the headgear that the woman, well, these ladies had Batman masks on. I'm serious, they just had barely cut out their eyes. There was nothing else that you could see. And they were wrapped so tight in that. And they're there, and whatever you want to think, that religion is so anti-Christian. Yet as they're in these stores buying all these things, they're hearing away in the manger. And hark, the herald angels sing. So to get their bargains, they have to listen to the gospel of Jesus Christ. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that wonderful? And it's just such a great, great time of the year. And we get so caught up in it, and we get so into the shopping, and I'm into that. We get into the food. The other night I baked 400 cookies. And I don't know why. I took off bacon and I made so many. I'm just an idiot. But anyway, it was really cool. Sammy's got this group of guys that go to Quaker State every Friday night at like 9:30, and they all piled in the house, and they started eating these hot cookies and going on and on about them. And then I'll send each of the kids home with about 100. And then they can give them to their friends, they can eat them or whatever. But it's the unhealthy lifestyle that is known as being a brown. And we really enjoy that. It's a lot of fun. And today I'll be bombarded. I have not wrapped a gift yet. I'll get into wrapping, and I'll get into knowing the kids are coming tomorrow, have a big dinner, and all the things that are going on. And it's just so incredible, and it's so exciting, and so fun. But every now and then, and I hope you get this in Christmas, I stop and think about what Christmas is. And I realize I'm not a very good person. I'm really not. Because I think about what good is. And I think about how I fall short of being good. You know, I saw yesterday some people being mean to other people. And when I see people being mean and hateful to other people, I want to punch them in the face. I just want to knock them down and say, would you like to reevaluate your life? This little girl, she sells coffee. How can you sit here and scream at her like this and live with yourself? I want to do that. And I get all mad. I get all upset. And then I think, Jesus never hit anybody, did he? Never punched anybody. And I think, well, I'm pretty awful. And then I get off and I'm off shopping and everything. And I don't know if you do this or not, but I found out that there's an awful lot of people out there that say they're Christmas shopping that's buying stuff for themselves. And they're not, because the fitting rooms are full. And you know, you don't try stuff on for your sister, do you? Caught up in that too. I'll get an ad in the mail and I'll say, ooh, look at the price on that Callaway driver. Wow. Yeah, it's gonna be a good day for me to get down and buy that.
But you know what? That's not thinking about other people.
And then sometimes I get caught up in the holidays. Do you ever feel sorry for yourself? You ever just get off of the thing where you go off in a corner? I think that's what holiday depression is. You go off in a corner of the house and just sit and start feeling sorry for yourself. And it can just start tugging over and over and over and over. And you say, why did I do all this? Somebody might say something nasty to you. Or not be real nice or act like they don't care about you. And you go off and you can start tugging and you can start getting down and you get all depressed. And then all of a sudden it hits you. You know, Jesus said that once you see that empty tomb, nothing will ever be able to get you down again. Here I am, lip dragging the ground and feeling real sad. You know, moping. There's 400 cookies in the kitchen and I can't go eat the oven. Because the endocrinologist will start screaming at me. You know, you start thinking that stuff, and then you want to go to the is that no matter how good we think we are or how great we are, I don't know about the rest of it, but I sure need a Savior. And I hope that that's a thought that you can pull in your head, because I think that's what's estranged the church from the non-church in the world, is the fact that the church has become a bunch of people who act like they don't need a Savior. And I will, for one, profess to you today that I am a man in need of a Savior. And I hope that you know that you are a person in need of a Savior, because as much as you want to be, you are not fit to be presented to God without Jesus Christ. Amen? And see, that's what Christmas is. And that's what it's always been. And when we know that Emmanuel is here, God is with us, and we know we need a Savior, we know He's been here. And when we've reached that, it changes the entire holiday. And that's what we're going to talk about. Emmanuel, we need a Savior. Before we go to God's Word, let's pray. God, I thank you so much that you loved me enough to send your Son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus, you loved me enough to go to Calvary. You loved me enough to die on a cross. Even though I wasn't worthy, there's nothing special about me. You just loved me that much. And I know that that makes such a difference in Christmas to me, because I understand how hard they prayed for Messiah, how tough things were, how distant they felt from God. And I know that now that whole closeness that I have with God comes from you and your promise. We ask that you would be with us and help us remember that today. And if there's someone here today that doesn't know you, that they would desire to have that relationship with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It all started very early with the need for a Savior. You know, one of the things that you think about every now and then is, can you think back, how old were you when you committed your first sin? You know, you were a sinner very early in life. And most of you can't remember, but they don't call it the terrible twos for nothing. Okay, and the Bible tells us to honor our mother and father, to obey our mother and father. And at 2 years old, you knew so much more than your mother and father. It's not funny. Right? And if you recently know any two-year-olds or you see any running around, you sit there and think, boy, when did they wake up so much smarter than me? And that's it. And we don't realize that those beautiful, innocent faces are already sinners. Because they're already doing things that are against God. And it's just going to continue. And we think about how many sins does it require to distance ourselves from God? And the answer to that is something we don't like. One sin. One sin gives us complete distance from God. A distance that we cannot reconcile. And it's tough. We don't know how long it's going to take to sin. We don't even know how long it took Adam and Eve to sin. People are so torn about Genesis and about the events that happened. And it's an accurate story of what happened, but a lot of the time stuff is not explained specifically. I believe in a six-day creation. And I believe in a 6 24-hour day creation. And then he rested on the seventh. And I believe that in the Aramaic, that is described in perfection. And I believe in that with all my heart. But after that, when he creates Adam and Eve, the time frame is not there. So we don't know how many years it may have been till Adam and Eve sinned. There's a lot of people that have the belief that Adam and Eve sinned like the next day after creation. And I don't believe that. I don't believe that at all. There are people who teach and believe that Adam and Eve may have had 7 or 8 kids before they ever sinned. And you look at me and you say, well, how can they believe that? Well, it's very easy. Part of the curse is God says you will not have pain when you deliver children. Well, how would she understand that there would now be pain if she never had any before? And so we don't know the timeline and how long it took Adam and Eve to sin. All we do know is that Adam and Eve did sin. Living in perfection with God, Adam and Eve chose to sin just as we choose to sin. But in God's curse, he gave us a great prophecy. Genesis 3, 14 and 15. He says, so the Lord God said to the serpent, because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and wild animals. You will crawl on your belly and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel. This wording of the woman's offspring, and it even actually said this is, as we go into it, let me explain this first. This is called proto-evangelium. Excuse me, in proto-evangelium in Latin means first gospel. This is the first gospel. This is the first talk ever about Jesus, the first good news. And the woman's offspring, and you can even see this in some of the older translations, it calls it her seed. And you have to understand, the woman has the egg, amen? And the man has the seed. Except in this scripture. And the woman has the seed. Because it is from the Holy Spirit. It is not from man. And this baby that it speaks of here, this offspring that will be between Satan and man, it's our first offspring, Jesus. And it says that he will crush Satan's head. The Savior will crush Satan's head. He will defeat sin. But Satan will wound him. And he did on the cross. But this is the first foretelling of our Savior. And you notice that the first foretelling of a Savior came right as sin came. Man chose sin. God loves us so much that he told us there would be a Savior to save us from sin. As we know, that Savior is Jesus. So then people started looking for him to come, and now we know he's here. Because life went on with no hope for thousands of years. People prayed, were desperate. What can we do? They realized that we are so far from God. You know, don't you feel that in your life sometimes, that there's a distance between you and God? I hear people tell me all the time, I wish I could talk to God. I wish I could just sit down and talk to God for a moment. If I could sit down and talk to God, I explain what I try to tell them. God does talk to you. If you read his word, you'll understand more. They don't like that answer. They want writing on the wall. You know? As in the book of Daniel. They want a bush on fire. But we know that we're far from God because we look at the people that we think of some of the greatest people that ever lived. Moses. Moses, such a great man of God. God called him his friend. Moses was a murderer. Most of us, hopefully all of us, will never take a man's life. This would have been in war. But we will never take another person's life just to murder somebody. Out of anger, out of being upset. Moses, the one that several people in the world even worship, out of anger, he took a man's life. Everybody understands that, right? He went out and saw one of the slave masters meeting with one of his people, and the Hebrew people, and said, he killed him. Then he ran and went into hiding for the murder. And you know, it was after that that God used him. It was after the murder that him and God became such good friends. David. We all know about David and Bathsheba. And you know, that's brought up. David did a lot of things wrong. David, one of the things that David did wrong was he was so proud of his country, he took a census after God forbid it. And God was just devastated that he did that and out and out. Disobedience. And we just think David's the greatest, right? King David, and we tell the proud stories about him. You know, kids say, I want to be like David. But David was a sinner and far from God. You see, we all fall short of the glory of God. The Bible tells us that. But then there's the good news, which is why we're excited. Luke 2, 10 through 11. But the angel said, don't be afraid. I have good news for you, which will make everyone happy. This very day in King David's hometown, a Savior was born for you. He is Christ the Lord. Notice the Savior. Every man talked this week. He was talking about shepherds. And he's a big, wonderful preacher. He said that shepherds were basically homeless people. If you're driving through Columbus today, you see a person that's got gloves with no fingers on, and a hat, and their coats are filthy. They're real layered, and obviously they've been laying in their own urine and drinking beyond belief. And you see all these things, and you become disgusted by that. That's the shepherds. You see, shepherding is a job that people took when they could not get any other job. They became a shepherd. Now, there's two kinds of shepherds, and you have to be careful in reading because the Bible says that Jesus was the good shepherd. And you say, well, Pastor David, are you saying that Jesus looks like a guy that's been urinating on himself, his clothes are all torn up and everything? No, because there's two kinds of shepherds. There were the shepherds that owned the sheep, and obviously Jesus owns us. He made us. Amen? So he obviously owns us. And they were quite different from how I see. But there were the guys who lived out in the fields. And the reason they did that, their only pay was they were allowed to eat some sheep. That was it. And the Bible tells us that those shepherds, if a wolf came up and stuff, half the time they just ran. They didn't even care about taking care of the sheep. So you have this group of these kind of guys outside of Bethlehem, and God is making the announcement to the world that the Messiah is here, and who does he go to? The shepherds. Now, I'm going to explain to you what shepherds were like. Shepherds were that group that if you're walking down the street and your wife is 5 feet over here, and you get near the shepherds, you grab your wife and pull her over and put your arm around her. Maybe even put her to your left side. If you have your kids, you pull them over because you know what these guys are like. And you don't know what's going through their mind. And God picks these people to send his message. And what does his message say? A Savior was born for you. You. A Savior was born for you, not for the world, not for people who think better than everybody. For you. Because we are a Savior. We are in need of the promised Messiah, Christ. He is the Messiah. He is Christ the Lord. This is the one you've been praying for, folks. This is the one you've been hoping for. This is the one that if you jump on the wagon, this is the one that's going to get you back in God's favor. Isn't that exciting? Because I want to be in God's favor. I don't want God to be upset with me. I don't want God to be mad at me. I want me and God to be just like this. Amen? Isn't that where you are? And see, the only way that I can be like that with God is with a Savior. And that Savior is Christ the Lord. Jesus Christ the Lord. So we come down today to the final question, and that is, do you need a Savior? You see, we can get to where we think pretty highly of ourselves, can't we? Can't we get pretty highly? I took Sammy. I'm really blessed. Sammy has picked Cincinnati. I don't even know what it's called. It was called Cincinnati Bible College. It was called CBS, or Cincinnati Bible Seminary, and now it's called CCU. And all it does is it's the world making me look stupid. Megan Coy's going there, and I went to the family the other day, and I said, I'm so excited that Sammy's going to be going to college with Megan at Cincinnati Bible College. And they looked at me and said, that's not what it's called. I didn't even respond. I just stuck my tongue out. They keep changing the name, and I can't keep up. But I met the dean of theology, and I was really impressed with him because we went to some other places, and it was so distant. And the dean of theology gave Sammy his personal cell phone number. I just thought that was absolutely wonderful. But he said, I want to tell you about our new theology program. He said, our new ministry tract is called Public Theology. And I looked at him and I said, what is public theology, Jamie? And he said, public theology is designed to get the church to quit pointing fingers and living like Jesus. I want to say that again. Public theology is to get the church to quit pointing fingers and live like Jesus. Amen? You think that might change the world? See, you know, no matter what you think, this might be like a rabbit track that you get off or something. How hard is it to get people to come to church anymore? You notice that? Every church is out struggling. How do we get people to come to church? But you want to know something? As you read through those Gospels, how many people followed Jesus Christ everywhere he went? Anybody? Is the word thousands come into your head? Thousands of people. Here's the other thing. It's tough to get kids interested in church. Amen? We have two different stories in the Bible where the disciples are getting mad because they can't keep the children away from Jesus. Because Jesus was not a pointer. Jesus was not an accuser. Jesus was a lover. He loved people. And that's why he came to be their Savior. And we can get high and mighty and think that we don't need a Savior. We can get arrogant. As a small boy in a small church I grew up, and you listen to people when you're 7 and 8 and you don't really understand. And I remember this one older lady in the church just thought of a fit because grandma said today's choir special was Amy, or not Amy Grant. No, trust me, it was not Amy Grant at Pleasant Grove. Today's special is Amazing Grace. And this lady started to walk back in. She wasn't singing in the choir. Grandma looked at her and said, what's wrong? Why aren't you singing today? And she said, I have not been, nor will I ever be a wretch, and I will not sing it. And she went and sat down. Mary said, I was like 7. And here I am, 57, 50 years later. I remember that lady saying that. And do you know what? As I've thought about that in my mind over 50 years, I realize that I am a wretch. I am. And it's just amazing. I get thinking that I do a lot of good. You know, I was in a meeting in Southeast one time. We went down there for a seminar, and I went to a seminar called How to Volunteers in the Church. Because they talked about church attendance. If you think that's tough, try getting volunteers in 2017. Try to get people that are fired up to do things in the church. And I went to this seminar, and this guy stood up, and he just started crying. And he said, they're mad at me and my church because I've cut back on how many jobs I was doing. He said, I was on like 9 committees. I had 6 other jobs I was doing. He said, I quit it all because I was doing those things because I thought I had to work my way to the kingdom of heaven. I had no concept of grace. He said, then I was reading the Bible and God broke my heart and told me that I cannot work my way to the kingdom of heaven. Jesus did all the work for me because Jesus is his Savior. And see, that's what we can start thinking we can do a lot of good, but it doesn't work. It all comes down to that tough point that we need a Savior. We need a Savior. Given the opportunity, we will sin. We will sin. How many people are going to sin tomorrow on the birth of Christ? Raise your hand. I guarantee I am. I will probably have 3 turkey sandwiches and 7 hams. I will eat a ton of cookies. Now you say, well, Pastor Dan, you're sinning. That's just Christmas. That's the festivus. Okay, let's get to the point. God says to treat our bodies like we're a temple. If my endocrinologist was here right now, he would tell you that I am destroying my temple. That bread and cookies are evil. Don't you hate me? I'll tell you a funny story. Me and this guy don't get along. And I go in the other day, and I'm sitting there, and this is how God does stuff. He's always giving me these newfangled drugs that the insurance companies refuse. Has that happened to anybody else yet? But, you know, because you think you're going to die, right? The doctor gives you this drug and says you need this drug, and you go, and they don't fill up at the pharmacy, and they say your insurance company has refused it. And you're like, well, I'm just going to die. And this guy does this to me all the time. So I go and I sit down, and I look, and I'm waiting in there. You know, you always have to wait. And I look up, and his certificate says he graduated pre-med at Wittenberg. So he comes in, and I start telling him about how I had season tickets for Wittenberg football, basketball when I was a teenager. How much I loved it. And I said, you look like you're about 40. I said, my godparent's son went to Wittenberg. He's got to be close to your age. He was a big star on their golf team. His name's Chad Delaney. And he looks at me and he says, you're Lamar Kathy's godson? He said, Chad was my best friend in college. I have to look at this guy and say, now you're going to make me be this guy's friend. But you know, I know I'm going to sin. Because I know it's gluttony. You know, if you go shopping the 23rd, 24th, everybody likes to brag that they're shopping. But one of the things that you observe on the 23rd and the 24th is the people who have done everything to scrap some pennies together to try to make a purchase, to do something for their family, something they love. And everybody likes to make fun of those people and think they're procrastinators. A lot of them are procrastinators. A lot of them are just people who are out there because it wasn't until they got paid this Friday that they had enough money to even buy something for their kids. And they're just out there working hard. trying to get it done. And I start working really hard way in advance, and I think about all the stuff my kids want around, how much I'm going to throw in the corner, will they really use, and